The final item of business is members' business debate on motion 22911 in the name of Colin Beattie on the 30th anniversary of German reunification. And this debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons? And I call on Colin Beattie to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to have the opportunity for a members' debate on such an important topic, commemorating an event which brought unity and peace to our continent 30 years ago and changed Europe for the better. I'm the convener of the Cross-Party Group on Germany, and it's an honour to be a member of a group which highlights the importance of our close relations and cooperation with Germany, as well as to discuss the country's rich culture and history. I'm pleased to lead this debate in the Chamber today to provide an opportunity for us all to appreciate how far our democracy in Europe has come in the last 30 years. The reunification of the Federal Republic of Germany with the German Democratic Republic on the 3rd of October 1990 was a momentous event, which will now seem a distant memory for some, given the strength and the stability we currently see in Germany and the unity we are now used to across Europe. Yet few of us have forgotten the tumultuous and chaotic precursor to this event, which was the fall of the Berlin Wall on the 9th of November 1989. As with most historic events, we like to place neat timelines and precise fixed dates around our European history. It makes it much more presentable and palatable. Yet there was nothing neat or precise about the demise of the GDR and perhaps the biggest shift in European geopolitics in recent times. The wall became not just a symbol of a divided Germany, but a symbol of the battle between communism and capitalism. It became a focus on two different regimes, and the division was stark indeed. The GDR seemed monolithic and secure. It was supported by the USSR, and it seemed that this division of Europe would last forever. Indeed, as late as January 19, 1989, the East German leader, Erich Honecker, stated that the wall will still exist in 50 or even 100 years. Yet events were happening elsewhere, which indicated that the so-called Iron Curtain was crumbling. In May 1989, Hungarian border guards began to remove the border fortifications with Austria, and what followed was nothing less than amazing. For those of us that are old enough to remember the news reports of the times, and the reports on TV were quite startling. The sight of columns of East German Trabant motor cars wheezing their way across fields and country roads in Hungary were just incredible. No one knew what was really happening. Expectation was that the communist authorities would intervene. Perhaps with our memory of Prague in 1968, we even thought Soviet Russia would intervene militarily. For me, it was perhaps even more surreal. I was living and working in Bangkok at the time, and I was seeing it from a distance and through a multiple of perspectives. It was difficult to comprehend what was happening and unbelievable to watch the communist type structures falling apart. The power of individual citizens working together was prevailing over the Soviet dictatorship. And this was arising everywhere in Eastern Europe, but nowhere more so than in hardline East Germany. Hungary opened its borders and thousands poured over into the West. Nearly 6,000 East Germans at the West German embassy in Prague were allowed to leave for the West. By October, the GDR leader, Erich Honecker, quit. And by November, it was estimated that between 500,000 and 1 million people were demonstrating in Alexanderplatz, one of the largest demonstrations in the history of East Germany. Soon after, the Berlin Wall symbolically fell, the crossings opened, and East Germans were free to travel to the West. Families who had faced a literal wall being built between them were reunited after decades. Thousands flooded over the border into West Berlin. Subsequently, of course, the Berlin Wall was literally demolished piece by piece as democracy prevailed. And as political events hurtled out of control in East Germany, it took many months for the conclusion to be reached that artificially perpetuating a divided Germany was in no one's interest. On the 3rd of October 1990, just over 30 years ago, and after some 40 years of division, Germany was reunited. It must be very difficult now to understand how it felt like when the division of Germany ended. For me, this was a continuation of the democratic process in Europe. For Germany, the beginning of a huge task in rebuilding East Germany. The economy in the GDR was on the verge of collapse with a crumbling infrastructure, outdated factories and high unemployment. I remember in the early days a figure of €100 billion being allocated. In fact, this amounted to almost €2 trillion over the 20 years following reunification. All of that went into reshaping the infrastructure in East Germany. It was a time for courage among European leaders, and particularly among West German leaders, to conceive a new future for this new land. The fall of the Berlin Wall and the reunification of Germany was essentially the final nail in the coffin of the Cold War, and other Warsaw Pact countries followed very quickly in throwing off the yoke of communist dictatorship. Germany showed the way. The end of the Cold War ushered in a new era of peace and economic growth across Europe, and especially for those countries within the European Union. Indeed, joining the European Union became the gold standard for the emerging democracies, and they have prospered hugely as a result. We live in a globally interconnected world where cooperation and joint action on the huge challenges which face us are essential. Scotland wishes to play its part in the fast-moving, partnership-driven world. International cooperation is essential in this new world of ours. Germany's contribution to Europe has been massive, and the economic success of Germany since reunification has been notable. The country has made impressive social developments and has become a key player in international cooperation through the roles in the European Union, NATO and the UN. They have an excellent role model of a leader in Angela Merkel, and they have been at the forefront of difficult international issues which have required cross-country cooperation on matters such as the refugee crisis, terrorism, tackling global climate change. In all these, Germany's contributions to our global society is remarkable. We should reflect on the progress which has been made as a result of these events and in the 30 years of cooperation which has followed them. So let me extend my own well wishes. My well wishes as convener of the cross-party group in Germany, and I believe the well wishes on behalf of all Scots as well, to the people of Germany on the occasion of the 30th anniversary of the reunification of Germany following the fall of the Berlin Wall. I look forward to continued peace and prosperity across Europe and to a closer Scottish and German friendship over the coming years. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
We'll move now to the open debate and speeches of around 4 minutes, please. Maureen Watt, followed by Gordon Lyndhurst.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Colin Beattie for submitting this motion for debate? And can I also at the same time recognise his excellent convenership of the cross-party group on Germany? The cross-party group has a meeting this evening starting at 6 o'clock. And I beg your indulgence, Presiding Officer, to leave shortly before that because Colin has asked me to convene in his place so that he can stay and listen to future speeches and join us later. Many members know my long-standing connections with Germany and the German language, having studied it first at school. My first visit to Germany was at the age of 16 to the Ruhrgebiet and the Frisian Islands, and then subsequently working in Wilhelmshaven in the hospitality industry, waitressing and cleaning as it was known then. I'm qualified to teach, or was, probably a bit rusty now, qualified to teach the German language after studying it at Strathclyde and Birmingham universities and eventually working for a German oil drilling company in Aberdeen, where the working languages were English and German. Thinking back when I was I must have been working at the drilling company at the time of the fall of the wall and very quick unification, and I honestly can't remember any much celebration at the time, but maybe that was because everything happened so very quickly and people were in a bit of a state of shock. It does, however, show that nations, whether they're coming together or going their separate ways, things can be done quickly and easily where all parties act in good faith. It's helped that West Germany has had strong post-war leaders. Indeed, it's only had three since reunification. Helmut Kohl from 1982 to 98, he supervised it, Gerhard Schröder, and Angela Merkel, Mutti Merkel, who has been in office since 2005, but is shortly to retire. I think it helped very much that she is herself from the East, and that has given her a strong sense of leadership and over East and West coming together, which, of course, as we know, has not been easy. But she has made very many bold decisions, as I say, which have been helped by the fact that she is from the East. And, of course, Germany has always had strong support from the West. Who can ever forget the Ich bin ein Berliner speech of John F. Kennedy? In more recent times, with the Scottish Government and devolution, Scotland has built strong links with Germany. In 2018, the German Innovation and Investment Hub was opened by Fiona Hyslop, and in June that year, the First Minister led a delegation of 12 Scottish companies aimed at growing exports to Germany, which stand around £2 billion worth at present. Inwardly, there are 155 German companies currently employing around 18,000 people in Scotland. Presiding Officer, although I've visited Germany many times over the decades, until recently I'd not visited Berlin. What a miss. It's a wonderful, vibrant, international, safe city, and I've learned a lot about the history, not only of Berlin itself, but of the Wall, and I look forward to more longer visits in the future. I want to finish by mentioning the work of a Northeast artist, Sandy Cheen, who lives in my constituency at Newton Hill. He was living and working as a teacher in Berlin at the time of the Wall, and he captured the fall of the Wall in some wonderful paintings, which were displayed in the Rendezvous Gallery in Aberdeen, 30 years on from the collapse of the Wall. He described it as the most exciting period of his life. Few would disagree.
Call Gordon Lyndhurst to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The German people, conscious of their responsibility before God and mankind, inspired by the determination to promote world peace as an equal partner in a united Europe. These are words from the preamble to the Basic Law of Germany, born from the ashes of the Second World War. And I think it is fair to say that Germany has worked hard to live up to its stated aspiration, and indeed largely succeeded. That in spite of a lengthy and painful division into East and West. In East Germany, a regime that acted in many ways like the one that preceded it, telling people what to believe, what to think, what to say. A single illustration, if I may, of this inaction. The mother of a friend of mine living in East Germany, where she grew up, she wanted to become a doctor, but she was told she could only become a nurse. Why? Well, she wasn't told why at the time. Was it a lack of academic grades, ability, or interest? No. Simply because, as a young girl, one summer she had attended a Christian children's camp and was thereby tarred for life. Myriads of files in East Germany kept of people's lives held similar case details. And I think it is Angela Merkel herself who was told by her mother, of course Angela Merkel came from a minister's family, that as a Christian she would simply have to be much, much better at what she did than other people to succeed. So we must always beware of such a suffocating state system arising at any time, in any country, including our own. People losing their jobs because of what they believe, think, or say. Sound familiar? I remember being in East Berlin as the Wall still stood. The empty shelves in the shops, the mood of the people there and then. Colin Beattie spoke of the euphoria when that symbol of division came down. But of course, not the whole Wall, because part remains as a reminder of the past. And we should be wary of mindless destruction of remnants of the past, symbols that should be kept to remind us of our own fallibility. That original euphoria, of course, gave way to quiet determination, something that was needed by the German people over the years of work on reunification. because not everything in the former East Germany was bad. Communities and families often can thrive in difficult circumstances. And indeed, not everything in West Germany was without its faults. And following reunification, there have been points of disagreement. I was with a friend on a walking trip on the East German-Czech border after reunification, a few years after the events of the fall of the wall. Henry, a proud Markkleeberger — now Markkleeberg is near but not part of Leipzig, I hasten to add. In Edinburgh, the term Lether will explain the distinction to a Scots audience. Henry parked the car, only to be immediately reprimanded by a fellow East German for parking in the wrong place. Bluder Vessi, the stranger added, noticing the West German number plate of the car, which being translated is stupid West German. Henry replied very politely, but with a most German response, that there was no sign prohibiting parking. And he added, "Und im Übrigens bin ich kein Bluder Vessi." With feeling, he'd said, "And I am not a West German." So fraught relations, you see, that sometimes came to the fore in the time following reunification, sometimes somewhat humorous, as in that case, but in the real sense, there were many difficulties which the German people on both sides of the former border overcame and succeeded. At the end of the day, their determination, their hard work, their commitment, their planning, and indeed their humor have won the day. To quote the 133rd Psalm, verse 1, "Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity."
Stuart McMillan, please, followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I too would like to congratulate Colin Beattie for securing this important debate. I'm sure that if COVID-19 wasn't with us, that the celebrations marking such an historic occasion would have been a joy to behold. I studied German in high school and took part in a student exchange. When I was 15, the German kids came over to the Renfrew region of Strathclyde Regional Council, as was, and when I was 16, we went over to the Kreis Herford region in West Germany. As well as attending school for 3 days in the region, we spent the second week in West Berlin and also had a day visit into East Berlin. We had a tour of the Reichstag, and to stand in the building looking out of a window, seeing Die Mauer at the wall, only metres away from this building, only metres away from what used to be the seat of the German Parliament, was quite remarkable. Now, looking over the wall into no man's land and then seeing the other wall on the eastern side was also quite was an image that will stay with me for the rest of my life. But also been told that, now whether this was true or not, but it was a nice wee story, no doubt, to be told, but also been informed that no doubt there was somebody watching us from the other side, because of where we were standing. It was akin to being in a spy movie. But the visit to communist East Berlin was one of the most surreal journeys of my life. We used the underground and through passing through dimly lit stations, and the stations certainly hadn't seen any investment for decades, and it was really kind of like a scene from a spy movie. But we were informed of the do's and the don'ts in East Berlin, and it did seem quite harsh, but that was a memory that stayed with me. And as a 16-year-old boy from Port Glasgow, I felt a genuine sense of sorrow for the people of East Germany, but also one of hope for them. Now, the politics of the 80s and 90s certainly shaped my life, and living through the Cold War with the daily updates of the West versus the East, always painting a picture of oppression and fear about the East. And when a state takes to shooting its own people as they're trying to escape to get a better life, then it's no wonder that picture was actually painted. And Colin Beattie obviously touched upon the Cold War, and it's actually one of the things that as an MSP, when I go into schools and the questions are always posed about how did you get involved in politics, or what stimulated you in terms of your political thoughts. When I talk about the Cold War, I feel as if I'm actually giving a history lesson to many younger people now, which I clearly am, because obviously it was many years ago. But thankfully, it was many years ago, and things have moved on. But I remember watching the images on TV of the rallies leading up to the night that the wall came down, and genuinely shedding a tear of joy. Even then, I knew it was never going to be easy reconnecting with 18 million people overnight, and there were still going to be many challenges ahead. However, if any country could do it, it was going to be the former West Germany, but also once again becoming that unified German nation. At university, I studied in the Fachhochschule in Dortmund, and I thoroughly enjoyed the experience, but certainly one of the things that I really took about my time there in 1995 was actually talking to German students about how they felt reunification has developed, and also their thoughts about the future. And certainly the one of the things that really struck me was the hope that the people from the western part of Germany actually had about the East, and their aspirations for the people from the East. Absolutely.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm sorry I can't participate in all of this very interesting debate, but I was in Germany in 1990 when the wall came down. I was one of those soldiers based out there. And you talk about tears of joy. Would you accept that it was quite a moving experience, having been on the front line, as it were, of the Cold War, to open up the gates of our barracks to welcome in East Germans and to look after them until their country could take them back after the wall had come down? And will you pay tribute, as I often do, to all of my fellow soldiers for the absolute welcome that was given to these people in probably the most difficult times they faced?
Stuart McMillan.
Absolutely agree with Edward Mountain, and I genuinely do pay tribute to the soldiers who were involved, but I think also to everyone who was involved at the time to try to make what clearly was going to be a momentous activity in world history, to try to make it as easy as possible in terms of that transition. Presiding Officer, I genuinely admire what Germany has undertaken and their actions in recent years, accepting over 1 million refugees. I think it's a lesson for all governments and also humanitarianism. And after reunification, I remember fretting. Some people are actually fretting about actually the reunification and because of history. But I always took the position, even as a 16-year-old boy and right through to now, I always took that position that reunification was not about looking back and going back. It was about, bringing people together, and to use certainly a phrase from today's politics, it was about building back better. Germany did that, and I genuinely am proud of what the German people have achieved. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think the second half of Colin Beattie's motion is absolutely accurate and also indicates the interdependencies of the global economy, and with every nation facing COVID-19, and how we actually all act together to try to deal with COVID-19 is extremely important. And also, I do want to pay tribute to Germany's activities in that. So with that, just one very, very brief point, if you'll allow me, Presiding Officer. One of the Berlin stickers in my pipe box states, Berlin ist ganz toll. Berlin is really great. But actually, I believe Deutschland ist ganz toll. So well done, Germany, for delivering hope, ambition, and also security for what you've achieved post the fall of the wall and also with reunification.
Daniel Johnson, pleased to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm very pleased to be taking part in this evening's debate, in part because I'm a member of the CPG on Germany, although I note my membership is marked somewhat more by my sentiment rather than my presence at that CPG, but also someone with German heritage on my mother's side. And I think it is remarkable, thinking about German reunification now being an event that took place 30 years ago, because so much of what Germany is today, we take for granted. And I think that stands very much in contrast with where Germany was 30 years ago. We view Germany, as Colin Beattie, I think, remarked, as something as a rock of Europe, an example of good governance, stable government, and a progressive nation. But at the time, many people viewed German reunification with suspicion and indeed outright hostility. Margaret Thatcher apparently would go around with a map of pre-war Germany and its boundaries then in her handbag in order to warn of the threat. Indeed, it was George H. Bush who was very much at the forefront of overcoming some of those sentiments and ensuring that it happened. But likewise, more recently, since reunification, I think, again, we take for granted just how much progress has been made. And my I first came to remark on these issues when I first visited Berlin in 1994 as a student taking part in the European Youth Parliament. Indeed, I had the great privilege of debating in the Reichstag building that was mentioned by a colleague previously. But what was really remarkable then was just how visible the wall still was in 1994, both because sections of the wall were still present, but where it wasn't, you could see where it had been. And even if you couldn't see the wall, you very much knew you were in East Berlin and when you weren't. I then revisited Berlin in 2002, and you couldn't tell which part of Berlin you were in. The progress that had been made, both in terms of the buildings and the livelihoods of the people, was remarkable. So I think Colin Beattie's motion is quite right to not just mark both the historical event of reunification, the progress that has been made, but also the lessons that it has for us in the future. And in my view, the lessons are threefold. First of all, reunification was as much a human and popular process as it was a political one. The events that led to reunification began in many ways with a picnic that was held in Sopron, just over the border in Hungary, where thousands of people from East Germany, with the events of the Hungarian border becoming liberalised, took the opportunity to meet for a picnic. And in the subsequent weeks and months, tens of thousands of East Germans moved, having taken their cue from that picnic, so that reunification became an inevitability, not because of political will, but because of popular will and popular movement of people, both in spirit, in opinion, and indeed in person. But there's also the effort of reunification. It took €2 trillion over 20 years, but even today, those fiscal transfers continue. In East Germany, some 25, almost a quarter of public spending has, in terms of revenues, which have consist of fiscal transfers from the West and to the East. And that happens because of the common recognition, the collective will to ensure that German reunification is a success, not just as a historical fact, but on an ongoing basis. And indeed, 90% of Germans view reunification as a good thing. And finally, it is because of federation. Germany is a strong federal republic with a strong basic law, with the recognition in its very parliament of both the Länder and of federal government, the upper house consisting of representatives appointed by the Länder. So it's through those three things, popular will, an effort of reunification and through strong federation, I think we can learn lessons. And at a time when I think our politics is marked by exceptionalism, by withdrawal and creating new borders, I think the lessons of bringing down borders and acting in the collective interest is one I think we could all learn from. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I bring in Mr. Gibson, I think we'll have a comment from Maurice Corrie.
The Speaker Dan Johnson, made some very interesting points. I was very fortunate to work and live out in Germany in 1980-81, serving with the Black Watch out there. And of course, I saw it, the wall was up and everything was very much east-west. And I was struck very much by the difficulties involved. And those of you who know Berlin, you probably know in East Berlin, there was this massive tall tower with a round edge on it. And the great thing is certain times of the day when the sun shone, it had a picture of a crucifix. And in those days, of course, the East German police insisted that this was covered with Hessian during that time of day, and therefore it couldn't shine Christianity over East Berlin. But I think the main point which Daniel Johnson has made about the question of, you know, the success of it, a lot of it was down to the success of the fact the parity of the mark, the Deutschmark, in both cases. And that was something that Chancellor Kohl made a real play on, in fact, sorting it out. It was a big gamble, but it worked. And interesting enough, I was fortunate to serve in the Balkans, in Bosnia, and I was involved in the question of the currency implications which we used. And we used the German reunification model of making sure that we created a new currency in Bosnia, and we used the marker as our currency, our new currency, and we linked it to the Deutschmark as a one-for-one parity, and that again was very successful. So there are lots of things coming on from that reunification that worked, not just in Germany, but in the Balkans as well.
Thank you. Mr. Corey had wanted to make an intervention on Mr. Johnson to make that point. It's just to let everyone know that you can't intervene on somebody who's making a contribution remotely, because it's very difficult. Hold on a minute, Mr. Gibson.
Yeah, thank you. Sorry.
We're into chaos. I now call the last of our contributors in this debate, Mr. Kenneth Gibson.
As long as it's not least. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate my colleague Colin Beattie for securing debating time this evening. And sadly, because of Maurice Corey's recent comments, I'm going to have a disagreement here. In actual fact, replacing the Ostmark one for Deutschmark meant that the East German economy, which was only about 30 to 40% as productive as the West, meant that there was mass unemployment in the East because they were paying effectively the same wages for far inferior products and lower levels of productivity, and that has led to some of the continued social problems which still exist in the East. So I think that was a catastrophic decision by the West and has not benefited the East in the long term. Back to what I was originally going to say. On 9th of November 1989, the Berlin Wall, which seemed immovable in my youth, fell. For 28 years, the anti-fascist protection barrier, as it was ludicrously called by the so-called German Democratic Republic, had separated the people of Germany, Europe, and in fact the world. Less than a year after its fall, East and West became one, or as former Chancellor Willy Brandt put it in his now legendary sentence, what belongs together was finally free to grow together once again. Of course, despite only taking 339 days to complete, reunification was not without difficulties, overcoming numerous hurdles. Let us not forget that Mrs. Thatcher's UK Tory government of the day was a fierce opponent of reunification, as Daniel Johnson alluded to. According to late German Chancellor Helmut Kohl's memoirs, he never forgot the hostility he faced at a European meeting in December 1989 after unveiling his 10-point plan for reunification. Mrs. Thatcher told astonished heads of state during dinner that, and I quote, "We beat the Germans twice and now they're back." However, despite these reactionary views, we now regard 3rd of October 1990 as a successful and astonishingly peaceful coming together of a once-divided German nation, liberating 18 million Aussies from the stagnation imposed by the SED, the Socialist Unity, i.e. Communist Party. For those who want to see what it was like in the old DDR, The Lives of Others, Deutschland 83 and Goodbye Lenin are well worth watching. The anniversary of German unification is therefore rightly a cause for celebration in Germany, Scotland and the rest of the world. And yet we must also remember those who fell victim to the paranoia of the SED. According to the Berlin Wall Memorial, at least 140 people were killed along the 96-mile-long Berlin Wall by East German border guards between 1961 and 1989. More than 1,100 people died trying to escape the former East Germany, and innumerable others perished as a result of the suffering and despair that the wall had on their personal lives. Presiding officer, the wall has now been gone longer than it existed, and although the physical markers of division have disappeared, some disparities persist. Land in the former West continue to be considerably more prosperous than the former East, where wages are lower and ordinary households own on average less than half the wealth accumulated in the West. A recent study by the Berlin Institute for Population Development found that half of all Germans still believe that there are more differences between Easterners and Westerners than commonalities. Although this shows that the healing of painful separation has not yet been fully completed, the peaceful cooperation between states from the former Eastern Bloc and the West does give us cause for optimism. Since the end of the Cold War, many former Warsaw Pact states have embraced democracy, the mixed economy, and subsequently joined the European Union, as a result of which the 21st century has seen more movement between European nations than ever before. It is a little-known fact that Chancellor Brandt predicted this development and actually referred to all parts of Europe, not just Germany, growing together once the Cold War ended. We must, however, also remember that the fall of the Berlin Wall did not end the presence of physical barriers in Europe. In recent years, we've seen the rise of those who put up new walls. In the summer of 2015, Hungary, which was instrumental, as we've already heard, in the fall of the Berlin Wall, erected a razor wire fence on its border with Serbia to keep out refugees. Over 20 years after the Belfast Agreement was signed, more than 100 so-called peace walls still separate neighbourhoods across Northern Ireland as an enduring legacy of sectarian conflict. The once unthinkable erection of physical barriers between Northern Ireland and the Republic is a realistic possibility, sadly. Presiding Officer, our celebration of the 30th anniversary of German reunification therefore comes with a responsibility. The process which began with reunification has not yet ended. We must all strive to keep the spirit of 1990 alive by ensuring peaceful cooperation between all European countries without the presence of walls that separate the nations of Europe.
I now call Jenny Gilruth to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating my colleague Colin Beattie for securing this evening's members' debate and also for his work on the cross-party group on Germany, of which he is the chair. This Parliament shares an important relationship with Germany, which I value hugely, not least in a personal capacity because my uncle Knut was standing on the wall in 1989 with many others as it was finally demolished piece by piece. As Colin Beattie rightly says, the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989 didn't just bring about the reunification of Germany. The heroic actions of many brave German citizens helped bring an end to the Cold War and the reunification of a continent. I stand here to respond to this motion today, not simply to mark that anniversary, but also to offer a reflection on Germany's reunification and what it means for Scotland's role in Europe and the world 30 years on. There are many lessons we can draw from the process of reunification and the integration of the modern German state into the EU, not least the value of international dialogue and the importance of international agreements being embedded within a strong, fair, rules-based European international order. As Colin Beattie told us, reunification changed Europe for the better. Not only has Germany achieved its own peace, which we must never take for granted, but since reunification, Germany has been central in promoting peace and prosperity across Europe and internationally. As Daniel Johnson said, we view Germany as the rock of Europe. In our interconnected world today, it has never been more important to uphold our internationalist values and the principles and operation of international law. Scotland will always champion those values and principles. Now, I can't pretend like Colin Beattie that I'm old enough to really remember the fall of the Berlin Wall, but I did ask my cousin, who was born in Berlin, about what she remembered about the wall. This is what she told me. It was a huge release of emotion when the wall came down. The wall represented oppression, division, hate, but confusingly, almost an element of security. Many people, Westerners, were frightened about suddenly being without a boundary, afraid the East Germans would pour into the West full of resentment and need. Thankfully, those were the minority though, and most people were full of joy. There was an electric optimism in the air. It's important to note that my family was on the West side, and that says a lot about how I experienced the wall. I was born into that division, and my experience was going through checkpoints where men with guns would circle your car and maybe make your parent get out to open and unpack the boot so they could examine all of your belongings before allowing you to pass. It was all threat and intimidation. As a kid, I was genuinely very afraid of the uniforms and the aggressive manner. I still now get anxious around military uniform and any sort of weaponry. But crucially, we were allowed to pass so that we could travel to Scotland to visit family. We never experienced any of the desperation that so many East Germans lived with. The life-risking attempts they would make to try and cross over for better opportunities or to see family from whom they'd been separated. It was very much, as we have heard today, a tale of two cities with two polarised experiences. Colin Beattie told us that the wall had become the focus of two different regimes. We should remember that in terms of how it was for the people who lived there and experienced it. Gordon Lyndhurst also illustrated the example of his friend's mother who attempted to become a doctor and was blocked from doing so. As we stand here with the danger of no deal or a bare bones deal and the harmful barriers that that will entail, it is more important than ever to look to our shared history for guidance. Three decades ago, courageous Germans made a stand and brought down the wall, toppling the barriers to cooperation, inclusion and solidarity, values I'm proud Scotland shares with our German friends and family. Peaceful cooperation can give us cause for optimism, as Kenny Gibson told us. As committed supporters of the EU, we will continue to strengthen the bonds between Scotland and our European friends so that together we can truly tackle the collective challenges that we face. Scotland's bilateral relationship with Germany continues to grow, helped by the work of the Scottish Government's German hub in Berlin. And Maureen Watt extolled the virtues of visiting Berlin, something which I am keen to do when we are able to do so again. That bilateral relationship includes promoting bilateral discussion and mutual support in priority areas like climate change and low carbon growth, economic development and renewable energy, including health and education. We're also enthusiastic about the wider relations and collaborations between Scotland and Germany across politics, civil society and business. And it was powerful to hear from Stuart McMillan about his experiences of visiting and being shown no man's land. He described it as a scene from a spy movie and feeling a genuine sense of sorrow, but also one of hope, which I think has been a common theme from most of the contributions this evening. Moving forward to the current day, our relations with Germany today include the recent memorandum of understanding between the German Wind Energy Cluster, WAB, and the Scottish Deep Wind Offshore Wind Cluster, which has a great potential to bring about mutual benefits in this key technology for our common green transition. We know that by working with Germany and its 16 states in key areas such as green technologies, health resilience and well-being, we can find solutions to the challenges we face more quickly and effectively. This government is proud of the relations we have built with German states in key policy areas such as hydrogen with Hamburg, Bavaria and North Rhine-Westphalia, our climate work as well with Baden-Württemberg as members of the Under 2 coalition, and with Rhineland-Palatinate in education and culture. We will continue to strengthen these relations as we mark the final months of Germany's EU Council presidency, despite the hurdles put in our way by events out with our control and shaped by doctrines that really do belong in the past. But, Presiding Officer, as Colin Beattie told us, democracy must prevail. Finally, I would like to place on record my thanks today to the outgoing German Consul General Barbara Quick, her tireless work in promoting and strengthening the bonds between our two countries, even in our short tenure, was greatly appreciated. And while sadly the Consulate's annual Edinburgh celebration of German Unity Day had to be cancelled this year due to the pandemic, I am nonetheless pleased that we are able to mark the occasion in Parliament. May I close in congratulating Colin Beattie on securing this vital members' debate once again. I thank all members for their contributions this evening, and to our German friends and my German family, may I take this opportunity to wish you a happy, although somewhat belated, German Unity Day. I am pleased to say that this government and this Parliament will continue to stand together with Germany and our European neighbours in the months and years ahead. Thank you.
Vielen Dank an alle. Dieses Treffen ist abgeschlossen.